दिस इम्पॉर्टेंट लेक्चर वी हैव विद अस विवेक कुमार सिंह, प्रोफेसर एंड हेड ऑफ कंप्यूटर साइंस डिपार्टमेंट एट द बनारस हिंदू यूनिवर्सिटी वाराणसी. प्रोफेसर सिंह हैज़ अ मास्टर्स एंड डॉक्टरल डिग्री इन कंप्यूटर साइंस फ्रॉम द यूनिवर्सिटी ऑफ अलाहाबाद. ही हैज़ 18 ईयर्स ऑफ एक्सपीरियंस इन टीचिंग एंड रिसर्च विद प्राइमरी इंटरेस्ट इन द एरियाज ऑफ इंफॉर्मेशन सिस्टम्स, टेक्स्ट एनालिटिक्स एंड साइंटोमेट्रिक्स. ही हैज़ अ रिच वॉल्यूम ऑफ स्कॉलरली वर्क एंड हैज़ वर्कड ऑन सेवरल research projects including those involving international collaborations with Germany, Mexico and Brazil to name a few. He is on the review board of many top tier SCIE index journals including Scientometrics, Information Processing and Management and several IEEE transactions. He is also one of the editors of the Journal of Scientometric Research, a life member of ISSI and the Computer Society of India. And he's serving as a senior member of IEEE and ACM. So without taking much time, on behalf of DST, Center for Policy Research, I would like to welcome Professor Vivek Singh. The platform is yours, Professor Vivek. Please take over.
Thank you, Gautam. Thank you very much. So Professor Abhinandan, Suresh, Gautam, formal good evening to all of you. I'm very happy to be here and very happy to know that the new batch has joined. So I would be talking, as Gautam said, I would be talking about centrometrics and how centrometrics as a methodology can be used for evidence-based science policy. And when we talk about science policy, we all know that, you know, we have to talk about allocation of resources, we have to talk about conduct of science, and we have to talk about how all this science translates to societal benefits. So when we talk about all of this, there's a lot of thing that policy has to, a lot of role that policy has to play, and the policy perspectives guide and shape the science and the conduct of science in many, many ways. And when we talk about centrometrics, essentially centrometrics is a method, or it's a quantitative technique which could give you the data, which could give you the evidence while you are formulating a policy or while you are trying to address a policy question. So that is primarily the context that I would be talking about. I'm just sharing the slides. I hope everything is all right with the slides. It's visible. Yeah.
Yes. Yes.
So this is what I would be talking about: centrometrics and evidence-based science policy. And the agenda would be something like this. We'll have a quicker part, which is about introducing what centrometrics is and some of the related terms and looking at some of the definitions. Then we have second and more applied part, is that I would show you with certain examples how centrometrics can be useful to answer some policy related questions. Then we move to responsible use of metrics. So we all keep on hearing, you know, about H index, about impact factors, about different initiatives that many countries have taken, that we are going to abandon impact factors and so on. So there's lot of things happening around science technology innovation indicators, and that is why people talk about responsible use of metrics. And followed by that, I would highlight some of the challenges that any such quantitative study methodology will have. And finally, these are two points, you know, that is my favorite, that I would like to put forward for all of you. You know, you're going to be part of the policy formulation and consultation process. So this is something, if you could take it to all the policymakers, to all the stakeholders, this is going to benefit almost everyone in the country. So this is largely what I'm going to talk about. Let's start with the first part, which is on introduction and definitions. So let's begin with you know, what science policy is about. So when we say science policy, because, you know, all of the centrometrics, infometrics, bibliometrics, they all have a lot of contribute to science policy. So the question is, when we say science policy, what do we mean by science policy? Well, you all are experts. Just to educate myself and just to you know, put the right perspective for discussion, I'm just putting forward certain types, certain points. So when we say science policy, we are talking about allocation of resources for conduct of science. And going a level further, we are also interested in translation of scientific discoveries into technological innovation, products, and so on. And finally, to make use of all of this for societal benefits, to improve the social and economic conditions of a country, of a state, or you know, of a region. So that is what we mean with science policy, that whatever limited amount of resources that a unit may have, when I say unit, it may be a region or a country or a state, whatever resources that we have available, what are our national priorities? What is it that we would like to use these resources for? And how to make best use of these resources so that we get the desired outcomes. So that is what, you know, what we largely mean by science policy. Now, let's also look at a definition for centometrics. So as we say that there's something, you know, there's a term called metrics. That means we are largely interested in measuring and measuring scientific activity. So centrometrics, you know, one of the initial definitions from 1971, and it says that centrometrics deals with quantitative methods of research on the development of science as an information process. So the idea is that science and scientific transactions could be viewed as an information production process. So in short, we call it as IPP. So when we visualize or view science as an information production process, centrometrics can be viewed as a study of quantitative aspects of science and technology, seen as a process of communication. So we have both of them taken together, science as an information production process and science as an information communication process. So whatever scholarly output that we produce, there are ways and means to communicate it to other scientists, what we call as inreach, and also to the general society, what we call as outreach. Okay. So centrometrics basically deals with quantitative studies of science, and particularly when we visualize science, the scientific process, as an information production process or as an information communication process. And there are a lot of things that centrometricians do. They try to devise ways of measuring research quality and impact. They try to find out how to understand the process of citations, what are citation networks, who cites whom, and so on. And then mapping scientific fields, use of indicators in research policy and management. So there are a lot of things that centrometricians do in that context. There are some other terms which are related to centrometrics. We have something called bibliometrics, a slightly older term, introduced in 1934, and it refers to the application of mathematics and statistical methods to books and other media of communication. So in a sense, it also includes scientific transactions, research articles, research papers, monographs, and so on. So in this way, bibliometrics is slightly broader, which takes into account, you know, almost everything which communicates science. Something even more than science. Then we have another related term, which is called infometrics, which is the most generic term in all of these definitions, which says that the study of application of mathematical methods to objects of information science. So it deals with all kinds of objects of information science, not necessarily scientific articles, but other things also. If you talk about a lecture note, if you talk about a web page, if you talk about a blog post. So infometrics relates to everything which is an object in information science. So this is one of the most generic definitions of, you know, the particular area, which subsumes within it centrometrics, bibliometrics, webometrics, altmetrics, almost everything. Then we have another term which is called webometrics. It is also, again, it's a quantitative study, but this quantitative study is largely related to the items which are present on web. So we are talking about web resources. Okay. So let's say you have, you know, a web page of a particular institution. If you're going to analyze that is part of webometrics. So web resources, when we analyze it quantitatively, we are talking about webometrics. Then we have a slightly recent one, which is called altmetrics. This is also known as alternative metrics. And the idea was to introduce it as an alternative measure of impact, alternative measure of scientific impact. And this essentially is study and use of scholarly impact measures based on activity in online tools and environment. So for example, if you write a scientific article and if you try to measure how many times it has been tweeted, how many times people have posted it in different blogs, how many times it has been, share on Facebook or some other kind of social network. If you're trying to measure that, and if you're trying to measure that network and the following relationship, then it would be known as altmetrics. So all these are quite closely related subjects in their own. So infometrics being the most generic one, followed by centrometrics, which many times includes bibliometrics, webometrics, and altmetrics as well. Now, when we say scientific output in information production process, what are the different outputs that we see? So what do scientists produce? So one important thing is that we get publications. Now, these publications could be a scientific article, it could be a conference proceeding, a review, book chapter, preprint, book, and so on. Then we also get patents. We have clinical trials. We have data sets. We have policy documents. So there are different kind of documents, different kind of documented outputs which are produced by scientists. And as a centrometrician, we would be interested in almost all these kind of scientific outcomes. Now, when we say we are interested in scientific outcome, then what is going to be our data source? So normally for doing centrometric analysis, we have to resort to a particular data source, and we call them as scholarly databases. Now, scholarly databases is one of the oldest, being Web of Science. Now, Web of Science is a collection of three databases, three citation indices particularly. So we call them as Science Citation Index, Social Science Citation Index, and Arts and Humanities Citation Index. Out of that, SCI actually started in 55. So in that sense, the Science Citation Index is the oldest citation index. In 1964, what happened is that the Science Citation Index, Social Science Citation Index, and Arts Humanities Science Citation Index, you know, all of them were in place. In fact, AHCI was the last one to come, and it was launched as a product in 1964. So in that sense, this is one of the oldest citation databases which we have, and which is known as Web of Science. Now, this, the other popular one that people use for this kind of analysis is Scopus. It's a product by Elsevier. Web of Science, initially, some few years back, it was Thomson Reuters. Now it is Clarivate Analytics. And Scopus is Elsevier, and it was created in 2004. Now, out of all these databases, the first two are manually curated databases. So what these database companies do is that they have direct agreement with different publishers, journal publishers, and then they take the data directly. So they take the publication data, and then they, you know, create mechanisms to monitor citations and the citation networks. We have another scholarly database, which is slightly different in terms of its structure and design, which is called Google Scholar, which is again of the same age as of Scopus, created in 2004. But the difference is that Google Scholar is not a manually curated database. So it uses different web crawlers, which could automatically identify that what could be a scientific article or what could be a scholarly article. And then treating that as a scholarly article, it looks for, you know, citation activity or the linking activity around that, those scholarly articles. So in a sense, Google Scholar is similar to the web crawling thing that happens in web pages and search engines. Now, one new database that came up recently, and that looks like to have, you know, a lot of promise, and is one of the most comprehensive ones, is Dimensions, which is created by a company called Digital Science in 2018. So this is one of the most, and this also is a manually curated database. So what they have is they take data from Crossref, PubMed, and they also have direct relationship with publishers where they get the data directly from publishers as well. So there are some other databases also, for example, Crossref, which is essentially designed as a consortium of different publishers to have the cross citation networks properly captured. And then Microsoft Academic Search, which was largely an offshoot of Microsoft Academic, which, you know, wanted to have a search engine. There are a few other ones also, for example, Semantic Scholar, as you may have seen, is another interesting database that is coming. But for centrometric studies, people largely use the first four ones, either Web of Science or Scopus or Google Scholar or Dimensions. And as we see, there are, you know, different databases, the coverage and the scope that all these databases has, that also varies a lot. So just to show you, the pairwise relationships, the journal coverage in these databases vary a lot. For example, almost all Web of Science is covered by Scopus. So Web of Science has 13,610 journals covered. Scopus has 39,758 journals covered, and there is an overlap of 13,489. So almost the entire coverage that Web of Science has is also covered by Scopus, and Scopus indexes many other journals which WS doesn't index. Now, Web of Science compared with Dimensions, again a similar situation, except that Dimensions is much wider in coverage. We have 73,966 journals covered. So this is as in 2020, a recent paper that we published in 2021, 73,000 journals covered. So in that sense, Dimensions is the only curated database to have the largest possible coverage of journals. And Scopus and Dimensions, again, when we compare, Dimensions is again many times more as compared to Scopus. So almost twice was what you have in Scopus. Now, given this fact that, you know, all these databases have different coverage, if you do your centrometric analysis by using a particular database, the outcomes are going to vary if you change the database. So that is something that we must keep in mind, that when we change the database, and there are also prescriptive methods to decide which database should be selected if we want to do an analysis in a particular area. For example, if you want to do something in management or social sciences, people prefer Scopus. If you want to do something in natural sciences or physical sciences, Web of Science may be better. If you want to do in computational science, Scopus may be better. So this is all taking into account the coverage that different databases have. Now, what are the different data fields and what are the different types of analysis possible? So one particular thing is that all these databases, they provide you data, metadata about publications. So they provide you data about publications from all the journals that they index, citation relationship between different articles, so which article is citing which other article, affiliation of all the articles that are indexed, publication source, so what is the name of the journal, who are the authors, what are the affiliating institutions. So a lot of publication metadata is provided by these databases for every publication record that they index from a particular journal. And by using this publication data, we can do a lot of network analysis. For example, we can find out authorship collaboration network. We can find out collaboration networks at the level of countries. For example, we can find out what amount of Indian research output involves international collaboration. Similarly, we can also find out citation impact of articles, which articles are most cited, whether these citation behaviors vary across disciplines, and so on. We can also find out reference set for all the articles. So when we download data, sometimes we have to say that we want the data plus references. And we can also get keywords which are normally associated with most of the scientific articles, and we could use it for a lot of analysis. And similarly, we also have some textual fields that are provided by databases. For example, we have title for each article. Many times we have abstract covered. So most of the journals also provide you abstract. We have keywords. We have concepts. All of this could be used to determine thematic structure either of a paper or of a journal or of a particular field as well. We can also have social media activity captured in some of the databases. So what Dimensions for that matter is doing is that Dimensions is linking another company that it has called Altmetrics. So some data from Altmetrics is directly linked to Dimensions. So you can get social media activity captured about scientific articles through different DOI linkages, and all this is captured through different aggregators and crawlers. And Dimensions and some other databases also provide with some more linking data. For example, that if we have a publication, whether there is a linking grant for that publication, whether we are getting a citation from a patent, whether we are getting a citation to an article from a clinical trial, or a citation going to a clinical trial. So a lot of these things are possible if we get the publication metadata from a scholarly database. There are some other important things that centrometricians always keep in mind, and I think you should know about them, is there are methodological considerations which determine to a large extent what is going to be outcome of your analysis. For example, one important thing that we have a choice is what is the publication counting method that we use. So whether we are using a whole counting method or we are using a fractional counting method. So the difference is like this, that if you have a paper which has 10 authors, so are you going to give equal credit of contribution to all the authors, or you're going to divide the credit of contribution equally among all these authors? So if you divide it, we call it fractional counting. But if you give them all of them equal credit, we call that as whole count. The other important thing is that all the databases have different kind of subject classification schemes. So different databases have different number of subject classes, subject categories. For example, Web of Science has, you know, 255 broad categories, then 258 second level categories, and you know, there are different kind of categories. Scopus has 355 categories, subject categories, and so on. And this subject classification in Web of Science and Scopus is permanently assigned. It is source based classification. That means that a particular journal is permanently assigned to a particular subject category, often more than one subject category. So as a result, any article that appears in that particular journal would automatically be assigned to all the subject categories which are associated with that particular journal, which may not be the best thing to do, but this is how Web of Science and Scopus do work. Dimensions has a new kind of scheme which is called article-based classification. So what it does is that it uses different machine learning-based classifiers to automatically classify an article into a particular subject area based on content of the article rather than what is the source in which it is published. So in that sense, Dimensions has a more forward-looking subject classification system. And number three that we must keep in mind is about normalization. So what happens is that publication behaviors vary across disciplines. So if you look in biological science, there's a lot and lot of number of journals. There are more researchers working in biological science, and as a result, there's a lot of publication activity happening in biological science, and for that matter, medical sciences as well. Okay. So as a result, if you have a large amount of publication activity, the citation activity would also be high. And that is where you may have heard about the fact that many journals in biological science or medical sciences, they have very high impact factors because the publication activity and citation activity is very high. So in fact, if you take into account the Web of Science or Scopus, more than 40% of the published literature or the metadata that they capture is in biological and medical sciences. So more than 40-50% is biological and medical sciences. When you compare it with mathematical science or engineering sciences, that is much, much less as compared to these disciplines. And as a result, you cannot compare the absolute number of citations or the citation impact from biological science vis-a-vis mathematical science or vis-a-vis engineering science, because there would be field differences. And that is where we try to do a lot of field normalizations or source normalizations. So sometimes we also use percentile based methods. So these are three very important methodological considerations that one must keep in mind when you do centrometric analysis of any kind. So two important things: one, what is the database that you're going to use? And number two, what is the methodology that you're going to use in terms of the choices that are available to you? And I must tell you that this impacts to a large extent. So I will show you a figure. Now this is DST's report, Research and Development Statistics at a Glance, 2019-20. And as you could see here, it shows India's rank as per data drawn from different databases. And that is where, you know, many people in my university keep me asking whether India is ranked third or fifth or ninth or 10th or so on. So there's some confusion that what is the actual rank? Well, this confusion is only because of the fact, and this, you know, this is going to exist there, because if you change the database, the coverage is going to vary, and as a result, the outcomes are also going to vary. If you change the methodology, the results are going to vary. So what you see here in this figure is that now this one, as you see here, as per NSF data, now NSF is not a database. NSF takes data from Scopus. So as per NSF report, which takes Scopus data from 16 subject areas, India ranks number three in terms of the total research output across the world. Now the Scopus report, again, that was a study commissioned by DST. It says that as in 2018, India ranked fifth. Now this one had a slightly more number of subjects selected. But the problem is, but still, you know, this had 16, this had 22. But 16 and 22 should not vary the outcome to such a large extent that from third we are going to become fifth. But what was also different between these two studies is that this used fractional counting and this used whole count. As a result, see, fractional counting penalizes those countries which have high international collaboration, because then your contribution credit is equally divided into different countries. So this is where NSF uses fractional counting, and countries like UK, which is about 60% of their research output involving international collaboration, they actually lose in terms of the fractional count score as compared to the whole counting. And India, which is about, 25 to 30% of its total research output involving international collaboration, doesn't lose that much if you use fractional counting. So because of that advantage, India is number third in NSF report, which also uses Scopus data as compared to Scopus report, which uses whole counting. Now, if you use Web of Science data, India is at number 9. Again, this is a subject selection. So based on what data you're going to pick up, based on what method of analysis you're going to use, the outcomes are going to vary. And that is why we need to know for sure that why this is happening, why there are variations. And most of these variations are either endogenous or exogenous. When we say endogenous, that means something which is related to the database. When we say exogenous, something related to the methodology that you're going to use. Well, let's look at another related aspect. When we talk about scientific research should not be viewed only in terms of the outputs that we see. So what do we get as an output? We get publications, patents, clinical trials, innovative products, and so on. Centometricians, or for that matter, all quantitative science people, they are largely focusing their attention on outputs. What is the output? But this output cannot be seen in isolation unless, we are going to give a complete picture only if we are going to look at the other two parts also. What is it that goes as input to the system? And what is the system in totality? What is the overall system in which, different institutions operate, different scientists operate, different researchers operate, and so on? So that is where when science or metrics or quantitative science should be seen, it should be seen in totality of what goes an input, what is the system like, and what comes out as an output. And that is why people are now talking about different kind of size-based normalization. So we call about publications per capita. So when we say researchers, a common measure to measure that is full-time equivalent. Generally, we say that FTE per million. So that is a common measure. Then we have another thing called GERD, gross expenditure on research and development. That means that what percentage of GDP is spent on research and development activities. Then what is the amount of extramural grants available to researchers? What about access to knowledge? What is the amount of access of different databases, different digital libraries, different journals that people working in different institutions have? This for a country like India, this varies significantly. So all of this must be taken into account when we see what is the productivity or what is the impact of an institution or a particular individual or a group of researchers. And also we must keep in mind that what is the overall environment in which our institutions or labs or industrial houses, they operate? What are the policies that we have? How easy it is to do science in India? All these policies should be kept in mind. So the point that I wish to convey here is that we should not overemphasize on the output side of, indicators, but we should also look at the input indicators as well. And we should try to see the output indicators vis-a-vis normalization of with respect to input indicators. But unfortunately, the traditional centrometrics, well, most of them are obsessed with the output. So there is a more focus on output side, but this is changing. So this is no longer the practice now. They use scholarly databases. There is a lot of focus on computing indicators. This also is slightly changing now. Now indicators are more informed, more situated in the actual context in which we operate. And now people are talking about size dependent and size independent measures. Okay. So we can't compare two institutions, one of them which has 2000 faculty members with another institution which has 500 faculty members. Because if you compare them, this would be a wrong comparison in terms of, you know, output you can compare, but because there was different inputs, so the outputs are going to vary. So if you're going to compare, compare per capita. Compare in a way where you can do size independent comparisons. So centometricians are largely interested in research evaluation studies, either at individual level or institutional level or country or regional studies. And many times people also do subject specific studies or ad hoc studies. For example, if somebody wants to know that what is the research and development activity, let's say in quantum computing in India. So what you can do is you can plan an ad hoc study on quantum computing. You can get data on quantum computing and you can do a lot of analysis, or for that matter, green chemistry. So you pick up any topic, you can plan your study, and Centrometrics allows you to do ad hoc studies. It allows you to do subject specific studies. It allows you to do institution level, country level, region level, or individual level studies. So centrometricians are interested in different kind of indicators. Indicators could be of productivity. For example, it is something which is measuring the publication behaviors. And as I told you, this varies across disciplines. Then there could be indicators of impact, for example, citations. So traditionally, citations have been the most popularly used indicators of impact, but new metrics of impact are also emerging, for example, altmetrics. Then we also have indicators of journal quality, for example, measures of prestige of a publication source. Now, this could be your site score, this could be your impact factor, this could be SNP, this could be, you know, percentile, and so on. So there are different things possible. So there are different indicators possible, for example, total papers, total citations. This could be for any unit. The unit could be an individual, this could be an institution, this could be a research group, this could be a country. So unit could be anything. The measures more or less remain same. TP, TC, average citations per paper. Then what is the cited uncited ratio for a unit? What are the different H type indices? For example, HG, HG, P, and so on. Then journal matrices like impact factor, site score, and so on. So there are different kind of indicators that people compute in quantitative science studies. But the fortunate part in centrometrics is that this over indulgence with indicators is now fading away. So people are now trying to understand centrometrics in a more broader perspective, not only, you know, in terms of, you know, computing indicators and just comparing units by indicators. If you want to know a bit more about indicators, I would, you know, point you to these three sources. For example, this is a wonderful source, Compendium of Bibliometric Science Indicators, last updated 2015. Then we also have Frascati Manual 2015 and Oslo Manual 2018. So they define a very large, you know, large system of science and technology activities evaluation and design of different indicators. It includes scientific publishing, it includes innovation, and so on. So there are a lot of things. All of them are from OECD, you can refer to them. So there's a lot of material to pick up from them. Let's now come to the second part, centrometrics as an evidence for policy question. So what I'm going to do is something like this. I'm going to pose a question and I'm going to see whether centrometrics can provide an answer or not. So let's look at, you know, a very generic question. How has Indian science and technology sector performed during last 10 years? So if we want to know what is it that we are going to do, well, we need to pick up data from a database and then we need to do some analytics. So what we can do? Number one, obtain publication data from a scholarly database. This could be anything, Web of Science, Scopus, or Dimensions. Then analyze the EOI's data and compute growth rate, global share, rank, and so on. Now this would mean that you would need data not only for India but for other countries as well. And then we can compute values for other countries and compare them, and we can report analytical results. So this is a very, you know, short summary of what are the steps that we do. Actually, when you do centrometric analysis, you have to do a lot of steps. So there's, you know, data download, data cleaning, data pre-processing, then different kind of analytics, extraction, and so on. So a lot of things happen, but in essence, we do these these kind of things. We obtain data, we pre-process and analyze it, and then we report the outcomes. So for example, if this was our study, now this is picked up from a paper, again a recent one in 2020, and this takes data from 2010 to 19, and as you could see here, it picks up data from all the three databases. So we wanted to show that if you pick up data from different database, the outcomes are going to be different. And as you could see, the title of the paper says how data sourced from different databases can produce varying outcomes. Now, as you could see here, if we pick up data from Web of Science, it shows that India has improved its rank from 12 to 10 from 2010 to 2019. Scopus says that India has improved its global rank in terms of total research output from 9 to 5. Dimension says that it has improved from 9 to 5. Well, in terms of annual growth rate, these are mentioned here. And as you could see here, the total number of research papers that are accounted for India, they vary significantly across all these databases. More agreement among Dimensions and Scopus, but huge differences between Web of Science, Scopus and Dimensions. And in terms of the compounded annual growth rate for the 10-year period, this also varies. Web of Science, the growth is 6.7%. Scopus, the growth is 8.1%, and Dimensions is growth of 10%. So the point is, if you pick up data, it is going to vary. So that is why you need to very clearly specify that what is the database that you have picked up. And please do not take data from multiple databases, because then, you know, this is going to be very problematic for your study. So use one particular database. And whatever cross-country comparisons that you're going to do, if you base it just on one database, the results are going to be stable. Similarly, in order to report it, we want to find out what amount of research output India contributes to the globally. So what is the global share of India's, that India contributes to the global research output? Now, as we could see here, the global share has increased in all the three databases. The percentages may vary. As per Web of Science, it has increased from 2.71% to 3.86%. So as in 2019, India contributes 3.86% of the total global share of the research output of the world. As per Scopus, it is 5.65%. Now, if you see again from different databases, the respective positions for India for last 10 years is also going to vary. So as per Web of Science, for last 10 years data taken together, India is at number 11. For Scopus, India is at number 5 for last 10 years data. For Dimensions, last 10 years data, India is at number 7. And the global shares also vary from 4.65% to 2.8% to 3.27%. Okay. So, but at least these databases and analytics can tell me that where does India stand in terms of research output, and how do we compare with other countries? So Centrometrics can provide me at least an evidence that how is India doing in terms of scientific research outcomes, measured either as, you know, this one measures only as journal publications, but you could expand this to include patents, clinical trials and so on. Let's look at another question. How has been the international collaboration patterns in Indian scientific research in the recent time? So for example, we want to know what amount of Indian research output involves international collaboration, let's say during last 20 years. Whether we are collaborating more now internationally, or our international collaborations have gone down, and if we are collaborating more or less, whether we are collaborating equally in all the subjects, or the international collaborations vary across subjects, and further, which countries we are collaborating more with and which countries we have lesser collaboration. So if we want to know, which could be very useful for science policy and science diplomacy and, you know, this kind of policy formulation, is we can pick up the data. Again, the steps are same: obtain publication data from a scholarly database, identify publications that involve international collaboration. So what you need to do is you need to look into author affiliation field, and you need to identify all such publication records where at least two countries occur. So there are at least two affiliations listed in the author affiliation field, two affiliations of two different countries. Then we compute the ICP instances, and then we do the analysis and plot the results, and we also identify the results at the country level. So what we, if we do this, what we observe is something like this, that for period from 2001 to 2019, so given the 20-year period that we have, 19-year period that we have, so what we have is the number of publications have increased significantly. And as we could see here, now this is Web of Science data. Sorry, it is 2019 and not 2020. 10.44% is the compounded annual growth rate during this period of 20 years. In terms of growth in ICP, international collaborated papers, the growth rate is high. So the international collaboration, so what we can see is that we are now collaborating more internationally. In fact, if you measure it in terms of percentage, during 2001, about 20% of the total Indian research output involves international collaboration, which has gone up to about 27-28% in 2019. So we are now collaborating more internationally, and for all science policy makers, this is a very important thing, because you know, science is no longer confined to be, you know, the kind of thing where we say ekla chalo, you know, that ekla chalo is not going to work in science anymore. So science is now multi-institutional, science is now multi-centered, you know, more people working together, the problems are more complex. So if you're collaborating with different people, if different people are working together on a particular problem, the impact is going to be high. Impact not only in terms of scientific impact, but also the societal impact is going to be high. And many studies have proven it that this is the case. So these are the major collaborators. This you could see USA is the most prominent one, the most thick line. Then we have other countries like England, South Korea, France, China. So these are some major collaborating countries. Unlike the collaboration, the international collaboration theories, which says that proximity is a very important thing, we are not collaborating much with, you know, our neighbors in South Asia, which includes Nepal, Pakistan, Bangladesh, and so on, because of a number of other reasons as well. Now, this international collaboration also varies across disciplines. Now, social science has 41.38% of its output that involves international collaboration. Mathematical science has 34.37% output involving international collaboration. If you see agriculture, this is much lesser, which is 19.60%. So international collaboration percentages also vary across disciplines. So Centrometrics can tell me not only that how we are doing in terms of international collaboration, it can also tell us with which countries we are collaborating more, which disciplines have more international collaboration, and also which disciplines have more collaboration with which countries, which institutions have more international collaboration. So all of this is possible by analysis of the publication metadata that we do as part of Centrometric methodology. Let's look at third question. What about gender in research publishing? So, you know, gender is a very important question for policymakers, and Centrometrics can also help in some way. So what I did is I picked up one important thing. So what you need to do, again, you need to obtain publication data from a scholarly database. You have to extract author names because you need to determine their gender. So what we can do is we can do something like this. Pick up publication data from a country, and let this publication data to be the data for analysis. So what we can say is that if out of the total publications, if X percentage is contributed by female authors and Y percentage is contributed by male authors, this could to some extent can be treated as a proxy for participation of female and male scientists in scientific activities. Assuming that, you know, the propensity to publish is largely similar, although that is not the case. So we identify author names, and then we have to use some service to identify gender. Unfortunately, there are a lot of services now. Gender API is one of them. So we can use a service of one API. Most of them use different kind of machine learning to identify gender with a, you know, with a substantial amount of accuracy. So these services also tell you with each name that they identify, they also tell you the accuracy. So what you can do is you can pick up that only pick up only those names for analysis which have, you know, an accuracy of 80% or more. And then we tag each publication whether this is female authored or male authored. Or, you know, because a publication may have both female and male authors, what you can do is something like this, that what is the leading author? Who is the leading author? Who is the first author? So we can say that how many papers have female first authored and how many papers have male first authored. We did an analysis for 10-year data from 2008 to 17. And what we figured out is that the female participation in research publishing has improved. So this one is the female to male ratio. Now this one, as you see here, it has improved from about 3.36 to about 0.44 or something like that in from 2008 to 2017. So if you take all this data together, only about 28% of the total research output from India for this period, as in Web of Science, has a female first author. Okay. So the analysis tells me that what is the amount of published research output that has a female first author. So this could be a good proxy for estimating what is the level of participation. Again, this one will vary. So you can also do subject area wise gender distribution analysis. And as we could see here, as one would expect, biological science has a better female to male ratio, as we have more female scientific workforce in biological science. Again, in multidisciplinary, better ratio. In medical sciences, better ratio. In social sciences, slightly better ratio. If you look in information science, computing science, mathematical science, engineering science, the ratio is not that good. So the participation of female authors in terms of research publishing in these areas is lesser. So this could be a good evidence for policymakers. So Centrometrics tells us, where do we stand? What is the current status? What does data tell us? And based on that, we can take a call that what should be our next steps. Now, rest two questions. I have two more questions. I would go very quickly. How impactful has been Indian research recently? So what we can do is, again, you can pick up the data. And the impact could be either the citation impact that you're trying to measure or the altmetric impact. And if you look at citation impact, India's citation rank has improved from about 14th in 2010 to 9th in 2019. So globally, we are now ranked 9th in the total number of citations that a country may attract. And our global citation share has also increased from 2.43% to 4.48%. And also we can do a field level analysis. So we can compute the relative citation ratio. Relative citation ratio is field normalized. So all the values that have, all the fields which have a value more than one, they say that these disciplines in India have citation rate better than global average. So as we could see here, environmental science has 1.42 citation rate better than global average. 1.08 is biological science. Agriculture and veterinary science, 1.23, and so on. Some disciplines have poor. Mathematical science has poor than the world average. Physical science has poor than the world average, and so on. Or if we are interested in social media attention, which is an altmetric, which is a measure of, you know, altmetric alternative impact, we can also calculate this. And one analysis that we did, it told that only 28.5% of the total Indian research output as indexed in Web of Science gets some kind of social media attention, combining all these platforms together. Mendeley, Twitter, Facebook, news, blog, and so on, as compared to the global average, 47%. So not a large amount of our research output gets social media attention. This may be because of a number of reasons, due to institutional policies, due to social media penetration levels, and many other factors. So this is what we can do. And the last question is how to select suitable institutions for funding in a given subject or thrust area. Now, this is a very, very important question where Centrometrics can play an important role, and it can also do away with, you know, a lot of problems that are associated with peer reviews. So what we can do here is, suppose, for example, India now has a lot of theme-specific programs. to select institutions to fund in quantum computing, to fund them in cyber physical systems and so on, specific thrust area programs. Now the problem is, how do we select which should be the potential institutions to be funded? Okay. What are the choices that we have? One, can we use international rankings? So we simply use international or national ranking. So can we use international rankings? Well, international rankings would be very problematic because of their coverage, because ARW has only 14 Indian institutions listed out of 1,000. QS has only 35 listed out of 1,300, and the has 63 out of 1,526. So at the best, we know the relative ranking of 63 institutions only. And that too, this is not only a research capability ranking, it has, you know, a lot of other parameters as well. And similar is the case with NIRF, which has lot and lot of parameters, which is not a research potential ranking. Okay. So the problem is, using international rankings directly could lead to another set of problems. Well, subject-based rankings have been introduced, which could be used, but again, the representation is very poor. So what is the other choice that we have? Can we use peer review? Well, yes, this is the most commonly used system at the moment, but is it really efficient? Well, if it has to be efficient, you have to have the best experts possible. Now that again is another problem on its own, how to select the most suitable experts. Because there would always be possibilities of regional or institutional biases in any human committees, particularly in the kind of setting in which we operate in India. And the conflict of interest policies, they're not stringently enforced in India, and they don't really help in that sense. And there is no mechanism to ensure accountability of the peer review teams. So are we going to tell, let's say the peer review team has selected three institutions in a particular area. After 5 years, if two of them don't perform at all, can we go back to these teams and ask them that you did a wrong selection? Well, no, that's not possible. So what would be a better thing to do is that, better let's look, you can do peer review, but let's also look at what is the evidence available. So that is where Centrometrics can be useful. So Centrometrics can be used in association with peer review systems, together with peer review systems, to provide at least the background evidence that could be used by the peer review team, which could be assessed by the peer review team. And this is not a new thing. This is happening in many countries for a long time. UK has a very well-developed system. Nordic countries have a very well-developed system. Australia and New Zealand have a very well-developed system of performance-based funding. And they do performance-based funding at both levels, ex post. That means an institution has been funded, and at the end of the a respective period, they are evaluated whether they have performed good or not. Or ex ante, where even before selecting an institution, we are trying to evaluate whether they should be the right institutions to be funded in a particular area or not, whether they have the right potential to develop as a center of excellence or not. So Centrometrics can help bring in positive discrimination. Of course, you know, you can always apply your wisdom, the peer review wisdom, to override it with proper reasoning, suitable reasoning, but Centrometrics at least gives you some evidence to base our reasoning on. And it can be combined with peer review methods in multiple ways. So we recently did a paper. So fortunately, Hiran is one of the authors. He's part of your team now. This is an X index which allows to rank institutions for funding in a specific thematic area. And we demonstrated it for computer science. For example, if you wish to fund an institution in artificial intelligence, what is it that you can do by using Centrometrics data? So what is the evidence that you can use? Well, we can answer more questions. So I'm just putting the questions. I'm not trying to answer them. Centrometrics can answer questions like this. Who are the most prolific researchers in a subject area? It can answer who are the most cited authors, which institutions do good in terms of either output or citations in a given subject area. It can also tell me what amount of research output from a unit, that means either a person or an institution, is available in open access. Centrometrics can very well do this. It can also tell you who are the major funders who are acknowledged in research output. So if you want to know which institution have which major funding agencies funding the research, you can get to know from the Centrometrics data. What amount of public funded research output is available in open access, which is also a policy of DST and DBT that publicly funded research should be publicly accessible, can also be obtained from Centrometric data. We can also identify knowledge clusters by doing spatial centrometrics. We can find out which city is doing good in which particular area, and we can also do a lot of text-based analysis and visualization that what are the thematic trajectories of a particular institution, what is the research portfolio of a particular institution, looking at the data for last 10 years, 20 years or 30 years. So there are a lot and lot of questions that Centrometrics can help you to answer by providing data, by providing methods, by providing analytical outcomes. Now comes, you know, the second last part, which is responsible use of metrics. We all know that we have to be careful about use of metrics, because metrics are prone to both misuse and abuse. There are so many international rankings, so many newspaper reports coming out that these are the top researchers, these are the top institutions, this ranking, that ranking, this data and so on. So one has to be very careful about a proper use of indicators, particularly indicators, because these are outcomes which have their own limitations. Similarly, author level metrics should always be used with a caution. They should always be used with the subject area in which they are being used, because there would always be differences between theoretical and applied nature of research. So somebody working in, let's say, machine learning computer science would be more cited as compared to somebody working in theoretical computer science. So there would be differences that we must keep into account. Then publication citation patterns always are field dependent. So that must be taken into account when you use indicators, and we must try to use size related effects as well. So one must be very, very careful when you use an indicator for this purpose. So I will tell you a very simple example. H index, we all know what H index is. H index can be used for a journal, for a department, for a university, or for even a country. So US universities have been heavily using H index for shortlisting for at least, you know, last 5 to 10 years, that if you are applying for an assistant professor, your H index should be at least above a certain level. So I'm telling you an example. Suppose there are three authors. Author one has published 12 papers and these are the citations. Now, if you look here, what is the H index here? Well, how many papers have that many citations? One paper has more than one citation, two paper has more than two citations. So this is citations arranged in descending order. Third paper has more than three citations, fourth has more than four, fifth has more than five, sixth has more than six, but seventh doesn't have more than seven citations. So only six papers have six or more than six citations. So this person has an H index of six. Now look here, all nine papers have nine or more than nine citations. So the H index is nine. What about this person? This person has six papers, all of which have more than six citations. So we have H index six. So now if you use indicator only, can we say that because the H index of author two is nine, so this is the best author? This is the most prolific, most impactful author? Well, look into this fact. The total number of citations of this person is very, very large as compared to both the authors. So simply because of the fact that an author has not published much, but whatever he has published has a very high scientific impact, but because the author has published less, so it's his or her H index is lesser. So simply using an indicator at an overall level may not be a very good idea. So it has to be seen with other, you know, overall context as well. Similarly, I10, I20 index that Google Scholar and many other things provide. So I10 index for people working in biological sciences would be many times higher as compared to people working in mathematical sciences. Similar would be I20 index. And the same cases with impact factor. We all know what impact factor is. Impact factor for journal in a particular year is the total number of citations that papers published during last 2 years got in this particular year. So impact factor for journal in 2017 is the total number of citations that papers published in 16 and 15 got in 2017 divided by the number of papers. So we are trying to normalize the total number of citations vis-a-vis the number of papers published. So we have 1.421. Now, again, as you would see, I will show you an example. So this is 2021 journal citation report. Now we have 2021 journal impact factor. See here, this is CAA journal, CA Cancer journal, which has an impact factor of 508. So what does it mean? It tells that on an average, every paper in this journal attracts about 500 citations, which is not the case. Because if you look at the data, you will find that out of all the papers, one particular paper has got more than 12,000 citations. And remaining all papers together have got 2,000 citations. So simply because of the fact that there is an outlier, the impact factor of this journal has rocketed like anything. This does not tell that if you publish in this journal, then you are going to have 500 citations within a period of two years. Well, that's not the case. Number one. Number two, if you are in a discipline which has a high propensity for publishing, your impact factor is bound to be higher because the publication activity is high. So all this has to be kept into account if you use an indicator of this kind. And perhaps the last 3-4 minutes that I will take is challenges for quantitative studies. Well, there are a lot of challenges. Quantitative studies of science still have a problem in measuring societal impact of research. So one must keep in mind that societal impact of research is different from scientific impact. So we cannot say that a research is very useful for society if it gets more citations. No, that's not correct. A research which may have lesser number of citations may be more useful for society as compared to another paper. So societal impact and scientific impact are not interchangeable. Number two, it is very difficult to find out effectiveness of methods of inreach and outreach. So science inreach means how much we are able to reach within the scientific community, and outreach is how much we are able to reach with our research outside the community to a larger section of society. So Centrometrics at the moment fails to capture the impact that, you know, research may have on scientists or society. So inreach and outreach activities at the moment are very, very difficult to measure. Some things are happening in terms of, you know, social media activity measurements, because social media is being used as a proxy for measuring the scientific network activity. So to some extent, inreach could be measured, but that is not the only and foolproof measure. And the last is, it is very difficult for Centrometrics to measure science society and society science connects, which is a very important component of science, technology and innovation ecosystem of a country or a society. So Centrometrics does not have at the moment capabilities to measure these kind of connects, because this is very important. If you keep on doing literature based research, your research would end up in libraries. You will start with library and your research will also end up in libraries. But if you pick up a problem from society and you work on that, most likely the outcome is going to be useful for the society. So this measuring how useful these connects are, this is going to be a big challenge for Centrometrics. And the last thing that I wish to say, this is not Centrometrics, but for, you know, for all of you, for some food for thought for discussion that I would like to draw attention of all of you, is just two important points. One is about publication venues. My premise or my submission is that in India, we do not have enough number of quality publication venues. And there are studies to suggest that availability of quality publication venues in a country, it influences the scientific research outcome of a country in many ways. So there are very few Indian journals of international standards. If you look at Web of Science, it indexes only 100 Indian journals. So Web of Science has more than 13,000 journals indexed across the world, but only 100 are from India. Scopus has more than 39,000 journals indexed, but only 400 are from India. Less than 1% in both the cases. And the new publication models that are emerging, they are putting new difficulties for Indian researchers with, you know, exorbitant APCs, which are going to be a serious deterrent. And the last and most important thing is that, what about locally relevant research? What about a research discovery which is useful for only for a local region. Where to publish that? Because no international journal would be interested in publishing this kind of discovery. So what we need is good publication venues where we can publish at least research which is locally and nationally relevant. So just to show you a figure, US publishes 6,000 journals which are indexed in Scopus. UK have about, you know, more than 5,500 which are indexed in Scopus, as compared to India, which has only 400. And the second and last thing that I wish to say for you to discuss is ease of doing science. And I'm you know, very happy that this is part of the STIP draft. I was part of that, writing that chapter, and we have been, you know, we have been very much involved in discussion about this particular theme, is that there are a lot of problems of ease of doing research, scientific research in India. So science funding systems and fund utilization mechanisms are too much bureaucratic. So I would not say the bigger problem is the funding agency. I would say the bigger problem is with the institutional system in which we operate. Okay. So at least I see, you know, in many state universities, many central universities, the kind of bureaucratic system that is there for fund utilization, for expenditure, is very, very problematic, which is, you know, which, and that is the reason why many scientists in India, they shy away from doing extramural research projects. Because at the end of the day, when you retire from your service, you'll have to run from post to pillar to get a nodules. And seeing the experiences of many other people, many people say that, you know, let's not bother about this. Whatever research that we can do from whatever fund within the institution available, will do that, will not seek extramural fund, which is very problematic, because if our best researchers do not do research, this is going to be very, very problematic. And what is the major problem? The major problem is that our funding systems are not trust-based. We have a huge number of GFR provisions, this provision, that provision, you know, UC, SE, and so on. And there's not enough focus on academic outcomes. So what actually is needed is all flexibility under the sun should be given to the scientists and make them accountable on the academic outcomes. Let them be free. Let them be free from hassles of, you know, management of the fund. Let them be accountable for what is the academic outcomes. Let there be a good peer review, evidence-based peer review. And we should be more selective, we should do more positive discrimination in selection. But once we have selected a team, once we have selected an institution, the institution or team should be given all plausible flexibility for the best outcomes. So that is something that is very much needed in India. And I'm pretty sure, you know, all of you being in part of the STI STIP process, you should put forward this, because this is going to benefit a large section of scientific workforce in country. So this is all that I wanted to say. My concluding remarks would be, Scintometrics as a methodology has a lot of potential to provide evidence for policy decisions. But at the same time, we must make responsible use of methodology and indicators, and they can help inform many science policy decisions if used in a proper way. And there is a need for combining evidence-based policy mechanisms with peer review systems to make them more effective. So this is all that I wanted to say. Thank you very much. I would close by showing you two figures, you know, just to make the mood lighter. This is my campus, an architectural marvel. You're all most welcome and invited to visit whenever you can. And this is what Varanasi is: the riverbank, the arati, and a completely different kind of culture that you will see here. And it's a place worth visiting once. So thank you very much. Thank you all of you for your attention. I would be very happy to have your points, your feedback, your comments, your questions.
Thank you, Professor Vivek, for the talk on the relevance of Scintometrics as a tool for evidence-based policy making, and especially